G-Man Boxing. Do you know what I mean? Every single live he donates. I see him on other lives donating, donating, donating. He's got the bag on it.
All right, people. Review of the week time. So, let's talk about the week. Talk about the fights, the up-and-coming fights. Preview Dillian White versus Jermaine Franklin. I'm actually looking forward to a couple of the fights on that card, truth be told. We'll talk about that now in a wee sec. But the first few things we're going to talk about, the main kind of bulk of this is going to be, obviously, Anthony Yard. Now, obviously, I watched the Queensbury card last night that was on in Telford. I wasn't really... Like, I watched Liam Davis. I wasn't really paying too much attention to that. I was actually quite impressed with Owen Cooper. I seen him against Jamie Stewart. Now, Jamie Stewart, I suppose we could say he's a journeyman. I think that's fair to say. But his record, you know, he's 3-3 with two draws. One of the draws is against Florian Marcu. Now, I thought he lost that fight pretty clearly. But he's got wins over guys like Mick Hennessy Jr. Mick Hennessy Jr. is absolutely garbage. No disrespect, but he's pretty useless. And, you know, draw with Ben Fields, people like that. But he was in there against Owen Cooper. Now, I don't remember seeing Owen Cooper prior to this. Looking at his resume, I don't think I have. And I have to say, Owen Cooper impressed me. You know, he came close on a few occasions to getting Jamie Stewart out of there. But first time really looking at him, and I actually think that there's a lot to be impressed with. He's 7-0 with two KOs. He's only 22 years old. And honestly, like, when I was watching this card, I was mainly looking at Anthony Yard. You know, that was the main thing I wanted to see, Anthony Yard, and then would he be fighting Beterbiev after? But I have to say, Owen Cooper, I'm going to be keeping an eye on him. I actually thought he looked pretty decent in there, and I'll be definitely keeping a close eye on how he goes. Now, in terms of Anthony Yard, Stefan Kojkov, that's how you pronounce it. Yeah, look, the BT Sports broadcast team, they really did do their best to make it out as though Anthony Yard was looking spectacular and that, you know, he's looking ready for Artur Beterbiev. They did their best to kind of make it out that was what we were seeing. I wasn't seeing that in the ring. I saw Anthony Yard just... That Anthony Yard is not going to do anything. He's not going to bother Artur Beterbiev in the slightest because he's wasting energy. Defensively, he was very, you know, lackadaisical in there. You know, Kojkov was hitting him with left hooks and he was hitting him with a few arm punches now and again. And again, you know, you'd look at that and think, okay, look, the guy, yeah, he's got 12 knockouts in 14 fights. I don't know how he has because his technique is crap. But you could maybe get away with being a bit leaky defense against someone like that. But at the end of the day, it's still bad habits. You know, you want to make sure that your defense is always tight, that you're not making silly mistakes, because if you make silly mistakes against someone better, that was one of the reasons why I was always convinced Josh Kelly wouldn't do what people thought he would, because I seen him have defensive lapses and get clipped with silly little shots against, you know, the guy is the journeyman he was fighting when he was up and coming. Excuse me. And I was thinking, you know what, he's not addressing any of them issues, so when the minute he steps up, they're going to be just exposed tenfold. That's what happened. Now, Anthony Yard, he's going to need to address them issues. In spite of what the BT Sport team were saying, I didn't think he looked particularly good in there. And I think that he needs a lot of work if he's to go in there with Artur Beterbiev. Now, having said that, I do think stylistically Beterbiev versus Yard, it's not a mismatch. Beterbiev, See, I don't know how to word it without kind of making it seem as though I'm picking Yard. But in a way, you could say that Beterbiev, his style plays into Yard's strengths. But that's not me saying that Beterbiev's going to win or Yard's going to win the fight. Nothing like that. I'm not picking him to win the fight. I don't think he will. But what I do think is that he's going to have more moments of success in this fight than he did against Kovalev. Because he's not going to have a really long, accurate stinging jab hitting him in the face from the first round. Beterbiev is going to be trying to hit him with everything but the kitchen sink, and he's going to be wary about that, but he's not really going to have to worry about finding his target so much. So this fight is happening January, and you know, January is shaping up to be an interesting month. You know, we're having, you know, Eubank out there as well. Going into February, we're going to have Josh Taylor, Jack Cattrall, Ryan Garcia is on about coming back in January. I'm going to talk about him and Tank Davis now in a sec, as well as Tank Davis, obviously. So the month of January, and normally, you know, even pre the old you know what, January in boxing has normally been a pretty dull month. You know, usually is. Usually, I guess because at the end of the day, you know, it's after Christmas. You know, for small hall promoters, the fighters, you know, the fighters who, you know, sell tickets, they, a lot of their fans or people who would have bought tickets have just paid money over Christmas. So that's out of the equation. A lot of fighters don't want to make weight. So January can be a bit of a dead month for boxing, but January 2023 is looking to be a pretty good month. And I think I remember January 2017 being a decent month. Now we had Frampton, Santa Cruz, amongst other fights that month. And 2017 followed 2016. 2016 was a dire year for boxing, much like this year. But 2017, that came to the rescue. And I wonder, will 23 do the same for boxing? In terms of this fight, look, I like this fight. I think it's going to be competitive, a lot more competitive than people think it is. I won't be, you know, going off the form book and saying, you know, Yared's going to win. No, but I definitely like this fight. I really do. I think that Beterbiev, he's at that age. How old is Beterbiev now? Because I keep forgetting he is. He's 37 years old. Now, he's at that age where, you know, you just don't know. You really don't, you know. He had two fights last year. He had two fights in 2021, and he'd one fight this year. Now, in the Joe Smith Jr. fight, he looked very good against Marcus Brown. At the start of that fight, he looked a little bit, you know, just needed to acclimatize to the speed. He didn't look particularly good in the fight against Adam Dienish, which was in March of last year. And prior to that, his last fight prior to that was Alexander Vodsek. So, you know, he's not been the most active. And again, he's at that age where you just don't know what will happen. And at the end of the day, one thing that you kind of can't overlook when you look at Beterbiev is the injuries. You know, when fighters start picking up injuries a lot more regularly and it's keeping them out of action, because bear in mind, Yared versus Beterbiev, the original date was, I think, the end of October. So October just gone. And Beterbiev was obviously injured. So when a fighter is getting up there in age, they're getting a lot more injuries, it's at that point, overnight, you could see a change. And I'm not saying that's going to happen in this fight, but God knows. You know, stranger things have happened. It wouldn't be the biggest upset in the world if Anthony Yard went in there and got the win, in my opinion. I won't be picking him, but it wouldn't be the biggest upset in the world. In terms of some of the other action that was on, did anyone know Jaime Munguia was fighting last night? I didn't. Now, I knew there was talk of him fighting, but I didn't expect it to come around this quick. It was on the zone, Golden Boy. And, you know, Munguia got rid of the guy in, I think, three rounds with a body shot. But I was like, when I seen it this morning, I was like, Munguia's? When was he fighting? You know, Munguia, when he beat Liam Smith, I was thinking, do you know what? They might have looked into something with this kid, because I think he's going to go places. You know, he's very fan-friendly style. At the time he was fighting 154 pounds, I knew he'd grow into middleweight. And I was thinking, there's a lot you could do with this guy. It's just been like literally, he fought last night. And, I mean, where was the promotion of it? Oscar De La Hoya, there was literally none. I remember them announcing a fight for him, and that was it. Maybe about a month ago, and that was literally it. In terms of some of the other fights, interesting, right? There was a card on over here up in Belfast, and it was actually on terrestrial TV here in Ireland. And I have to say, you know, there was a couple of good little scraps on it. You know, they're getting boxing back on terrestrial TV in Ireland, and they're doing more shows now, which is good, because I think we obviously have a show hopefully next year in Croke Park, which is going to be crazy, because you know, that's an 80,000 seater, a little over 80,000 seater. So the fact that boxing is starting to pick up a bit of steam here in Ireland again, and they're starting to show it on terrestrial TV, it's pretty good. You know, I seen Colin Murphy, who I think he fought on one of Conlon's undercard. I think he fought on Conlon's last undercard. He had a good win and a good little domestic scrap last night. And there was a domestic scrap between a guy called Owen Duffy and a guy called Owen O'Neill. The reason I bring that one in is because one of the knockouts of the year, in my opinion, still not quite as good and still not quite as important, I don't think, as the Lee Wood Michael Conlon knockout. But this was kind of against the run of play, last round, boom, out cold. That was kind of how it was. A crazy knockout. So that was a good little show with a couple of good little fights on it. So it's good to see boxing getting back up on its feet here in Ireland. In terms of boxing this week, obviously we have, well, three shows really. We have two on Saturday. I don't like that, but I wish they could have done it different, but AO, it is what it is. And obviously we have one on Sunday afternoon next week, which I'm actually looking forward to as well. You know, Sunday afternoon boxing is going to be different, but it's going to be good. I'm quite intrigued to see how it goes in Ali Pally. Obviously the Sunday show is a boxer show. It's going to have Adam Azim versus Ryland Charlton. It's going to have Lerone Richards versus Zach Chelly. That's going to be a good fight. You know, I'd be favouring Lerone Richards heavily, but Zach Chelly, he's improved an awful lot over the last few years. So be looking forward to see how that goes. And obviously we have Zach Parker versus John Ryder on BT Sport next Saturday, which is going to be a very, very good fight. Looking forward to seeing that. I think that one is going to, that has the potential to really catch fire. It really does. And I think with Canelo during the week saying that he's looking for a tune-up fight, I think the fact that this is essentially a final eliminator, without saying disrespectful to both guys, I think that Canelo would look at the winner of Parker Ryder as a tune-up fight before going into a pivotal rematch in September. So the winner of this fight, I mean, they could not just be a world title shot, but an absolutely monumental payday against one of the best in the sport. So a lot to play for in Ryder versus Parker. Of course, I'll do a prediction video during the week for that, preview the card as well, as I will with this fight. I haven't got around to recording a prediction for this fight, but Dillon White versus Jermaine Franklin. Excuse me. Again, a lump in the throat there. In terms of this fight, Jermaine Franklin, I've seen little snippets of him, to be fair. And look, he doesn't look particularly amazing. He's 14 KOs and 21 wins, so 66% KO ratio. He's gone the distance with guys like Pavel Sauer. He's gone the distance with guys like Riddell Broker. You know, both of these guys are not known for their durability. You know, both of these guys have been stopped before. So that's normally an indication that he's not got, you know, dynamite in his fists. But saying that, Dillon White, I think his chin, you know, people talk about Dillon White and saying that he's regressed, you know, that he's passed it. I think from a technical point of view, in terms of his ability, I don't think he's past it. I think that he still has ability. I think that he can still, in terms of what he brings to the table, in terms of his ability, he's still there in the top 10, certainly. But I think that that chin has regressed badly. And I think that it's only going to regress worse following that Tyson Fury knockout. Because, you know, we never saw Dillon White against Otto Valeen October last year. Now, Valeen's not really a big puncher. But Jesus, that would have been interesting to see what would have happened if he'd gone in there with Valeen, because that would have really told us how his chin was after Povetkin. We only found out in the Tyson Fury fight that his chin's regressed even further. Now, you add another devastating knockout onto that. I mean, I wouldn't count out Jermaine Franklin. Without going into my prediction video, I wouldn't be counting him out, put it like that. In terms of the undercard, it's not a bad card. You know, we have Craig Richards versus Ricard Bolotnek's. Looking forward to that fight. You know, Bolotnek's is game. He's talented. But I think Craig Richards should have a bit too much in the tank for him. I think Spider will have. And again, Spider, he may be looking at maybe going and having a Boazzi rematch. You never know. I mean, we've heard very little of Boazzi since he beat Craig Richards. So he could be looking to go down that road. Bolotnek's has been in there with Joshua Boazzi. Took him 11 rounds. So could Richards do a better job? We shall wait and see. But Bolotnek's game. And obviously we've got Fabio Wadley versus Nathan Gorman. Now I'm looking forward to that fight. I have to say, I am looking forward to seeing Wadley versus Gorman. I am. Because I think that fight, if we get Nathan Gorman in shape and fully motivated, we're in for a treat. I'm not picking him. But I think that him versus Wadley, if Gorman comes in shape. Now when I say in shape, he's never in shape. But I mean, you know, not in the 270s like he has before. I mean, how much did he weigh? He weighed 272 against Pavel Saurus. He weighed, how much did he weigh against Latte? 273, and his last fight, 268. Now, contrast that with Dubois, where he was 256. All right, he didn't look amazing in that fight, but Jesus, he looked a lot better than he did, you know, in them last few. When he beat Sean Turner, that was a good performance. Now, the best I ever actually seen Nathan Gorman was when he fought Sean Turner. And I think that might have been on the Fury. Oh, what's his name? The Albanian guy. I'll have to click into the event. It's going to annoy me. Yes, it was that fight. It was the Sefa Safiri fight. He weighed 249. And that's the best I've ever seen him. He looked sharp. He looked fast. And he looked powerful at 249. Still had a bit too much weight on him. But he looked powerful. Him coming in, as near as makes no difference, 30 pounds heavier, just doesn't do. Just doesn't do. And if he does do that, then Fabio Wadley's going to have a field. Won't be able to miss him. Going to have a field day with him. So I think that fight really does hinge on how good Nathan Gorman trains for it. Or how hard he trains for it, I should say. And how good a shape he's in. So we shall see. In terms of some of the news that's been floating around. And obviously, you know, the main news that kind of came out is Tank Davis, Ryan Garcia. Now it's reported that this fight is pretty much a done deal for 136 pounds at a catch weight. But both guys look likely to have a fight in the interim. The date I'm seeing reported here is April the 15th. So April the 15th is likely going to be the date, depending on obviously how good they get through their fights, because you don't know what might happen with cuts or injuries and stuff like that. So Garcia versus Tank, April 15th. Damn. I hope it's true. I really, really do. In terms of who Tank Davis will fight, he's fighting Hector Luis Garcia. I believe Hector Luis Garcia is he a super fetter? I'm not 100% sure about that. Someone want to correct me in the comment section if that's the case. But that's who he's going to be fighting. Basically, Garcia hasn't announced who he's fighting yet. But it's likely going to be someone not particularly amazing, you would imagine. In terms of some of the other news, Stanionis, the WBA regular champion, he's been ordered to defend his title against Virgil Ortiz next. Oh, that has got entertainment written all over it, lads. That has got entertainment written all over it. I mean, damn. That's got entertainment written all over it. In terms of Teofimo Lopez, he's actually going to face Sandor Martin on December 10th in New York instead of Jose Pedraza, I should say. So Sandor Martin, I mean, it's very rare you have an opponent step in you'd look at and say he might be harder than the original. Because Sandor Martin is riding the quest of a wave of success recently. You know, he's obviously got that win over Mikey Garcia. So going in there, he's going to be tricky. He's going to be pretty tricky for Teofimo Lopez. I expect Teofimo Lopez to win, but I think he's going to be a tricky enough customer. Let's put it like that. He's going to be tricky. Make no mistake about that. Eddie Hearn, he recently gave an IFL interview, and he's actually been talking about behind the scenes stuff that's been going on. So behind the scenes, there is a lot of work being done on Fury versus Usyk to still go ahead. Obviously, we know, and for Undisputed, obviously, we know that the IBF have recently just announced that Hergovic is mandatory. And also, by the way, it was announced with the WBA that David listed Daniel Dubois as the mandatory for Alexander Usyk. Which, you know, Daniel Dubois is... Well, George Warren confirmed that actually that Dubois is mandatory for Usyk's title. Dubois, obviously, is the regular champion. Usyk is the full champion. I know the WBA. You see, this is why I don't understand this goddamn regular super title. Because they try and consolidate them now and again. But once they do consolidate them, someone else picks up a vacant regular title. And it's just like, we're back to square one. What's the point in having them? Like, what's the point in consolidating them if you're literally just going to give the regular to someone else again? Because they've done that before. I mean, they did it with Danny Jacobs versus Triple G. And who's the regular champion at 160 pounds? Can't think of who it is. But they've done that before. And I just don't understand the point in it. But Dubois, you see, this is the issue as well. You're now seeing the mandatories. So if we get undisputed next year, mark my words, we will not be seeing an undisputed champion for long, because you're essentially going to have to think of what you're going to do with the IBF, the winner, because the IBF are going to have a mandatory, and that may, well, that's going to be Filip Hrgović. So are you going to go and fight Hrgović? Are you going to go and fight Joe Joyce? Are you going to go and fight Daniel Dubois? Are you going to fight the winner of Wilder? See, there will be four mandatories next year for all four of the sanctioning bodies. And at the end of the day, you can only fight one at a time. So whoever wins undisputed, and obviously I hope we get undisputed and I hope we do see it, I can imagine they'll be undisputed champion for all of a couple of days / weeks, because they're going to be mandatories coming left, right and centre next year. I really do think that. I think there's going to be mandatories all over the place. And, you know, as long as we get to see an undisputed champion, I'm happy. I don't really care about how long he's champion for. You know, that's not really what I'm looking at. I'm not looking for someone to be, you know, undisputed champion for, you know, the next 2 or 3 years, you know, defending it against all comers. No, no, no. I'm looking for someone to win that title, be undisputed. Whatever happens after, you know, so be it. We'll start the process again, because obviously I'd imagine that if it was Usyk who'd win, he'd retire. And I imagine Fury would probably do the same as well. Some of the other things Eddie Hearn has said is that he believes that the Anthony Joshua versus Dillian White rematch will happen next year if White beats Jermaine Franklin next Saturday. If Franklin wins, it'll be Joshua Franklin. Okay. Now, I wonder for this fight, will AJ be ringside? Because do you remember when Dillian White fought Chisora in the rematch? They had AJ ringside and come into the ring after, because Sky, they really wanted to do Dillian White versus Anthony Joshua 2. Wembley, April 2019, didn't happen. We obviously know how that story ended. I wonder, will they do something similar here? I wonder. Now, here's the part that I've been looking forward to speaking about, because I find this one an interesting one. So Eddie Hearn on Lawrence Okoli. He says, everything was positive until he started hanging around with people who have no idea. The last thing we ever want to do is go court with a fighter, but I will never let someone take the you-know-what out of the loyalty / job we delivered for them. Obviously, this is all stemming from Lawrence Okoli. Basically, it's going back months here. Because Lawrence Okoli, we know, it was a weird one. It was kind of against it just kind of came out with the blue. Okoli basically said that Eddie Hearn was, a slave owner? Or it was like a slave contract or something like that. That's how he worded it. I'm paraphrasing there, of course. But that was during the summer. And I was looking at that, where is all this coming from? And Okoli was obviously releasing some little statements on Instagram saying, you know, I'm now not able to provide, I'm trying to get out of this contract. As far as I'm aware, he is out of the Matchroom contract now. But it's a weird one. I mean, Eddie Hearn prided himself of being someone who, he's not in court with fighters. Now, he obviously has some court issues now, obviously with Jake Paul. That's not to do with fighter promoter. That's legit. I don't blame Eddie Hearn really for actually taking the legal road with that, because Jake Paul basically accused Eddie Hearn of corrupting boxing. You know, basically saying that officials, I'm paraphrasing here, but I believe it was, you take money or something like that, you're paying off officials. Without proof to back that up, that's a really, really serious allegation. So you can understand why Eddie Hearn would go the legal road with that. I mean, I'm sure everyone has, you know, their kind of limit to which they let people say this about them. And then once you say something like that, it's like, ah, no, you're taking the piss. I'm not having that. So I understand that one. With fighters, I mean, is this going to court? Maybe. You know, judging by that IFL interview, you would say possibly. But obviously, Lawrence Okoli wants just to get this. As far as I'm aware, he was out of this contract. You know, there was one fight left, but apparently, from what I heard, that wasn't happening. So someone wants to update me fully on what's going on there. I was under the impression Okoli was free now to do what he wanted. In terms of what Eddie Hearn was saying here, he's hanging around people who have no idea. Now, I don't know who he's referring to there, but I would imagine that Okoli, his next move will probably be to Sky. And, you know, I would normally always side with the fighter in these situations. Because at the end of the day, A fighter has so long to make the most of his ability, to make the most money for himself, and to make the most of his talent. A promoter, Eddie Hearn, Ben Shalom, Frank Warren, they can keep going and going and going and going and going long after that fighter is retired. So they're going to keep making money for as long as they want, but that fighter only has a short window to make life-changing money. And if a promoter isn't doing the job for that fighter, I've no issue with them saying, see you later, cutting your losses, trying not to go down the legal road, but going elsewhere. But with this one, I think that Eddie Hearn has been really put in a bad light by Lawrence Okolie. Because at the end of the day, let's assess what Eddie Hearn has done as a promoter for Lawrence Okolie, right? Took him from the amateurs, right? Took him, turned him pro, 27 in. Literally, from the start, he was on AJ undercards. He was Sky, were, you know, backing him. Sky were even trying to make him. I remember a few of the interviews in Okolie's early fights, where it was literally they were trying to make AJ 2.0. It was so cheesy, the interviews and the responses Okolie was given. I remember some of them, I was just cringing. And I think Sky realized, yeah, this ain't going to work with him. So they kind of binned the whole kind of cringy kind of, because some of them were just cringe, like putting potatoes on his shorts and just being like, just Pufufu. It was just so, I was just like, that's cringe, man. So they got rid of that. But Sky were obviously backing Okolie. Eddie Hearn was backing him. 2018, he hadn't even been pro a year. Puts him in the O2, headlining in a 10-rounder against Isaac Chamberlain. Chamberlain had been with Eddie Hearn for, I think, a year or two. He'd been with Eddie Hearn longer. He was with Eddie Hearn in 2016. And Okolie and Chamberlain. Okolie holds, stinks the place out, but he wins the fight nonetheless. Right? He wins that fight nonetheless. Didn't look good. Really, really stunk the place out. That was the same night. In fact, actually, that fight was going on at the same time. I remember watching it as Garcia versus Dorticos. And I mean, you talk about two contrasting fights. You had one fight with cruiserweights, actually, both cruiserweights. You had one cruiserweight fight that stunk the place out. You had the other one that just set the place alight. But Eddie Hearn still works with him, keeps fading him. Headlines on a Next Gen show in New York Hall in June 2018 against Luke Watkins. Knocks him out in a couple of rounds. Eddie Hearn then puts him on the undercard of Joshua Povetkin in Wembley, fighting Matty Askin. And Lawrence Okolie outdid himself. He somehow had a worse fight than the fight with Chamberlain, as if that was possible. So in the space of a year, less than a year, 10 months, less, he stunk the place out twice. Twice he stunk the place out. Now, a lot of promoters at that point would have just washed their hands with him. They would have either just tried to get rid of him or not extend his contract, or they would have fed him to someone who was always going to beat him. But what did Eddie Hearn do? Didn't do any of that. Frank Warren, I'm telling you now, if there was a fighter who stunk the place out like Okolie did twice in less than a year, Frank Warren would have either got rid of that contract when it was over, or he would have fed him to someone who was always going to beat him. You know, like feed him to someone before he's ready. Warren wouldn't have been that patient. He wouldn't have been. But Eddie Hearn was. Kept working with him in 2019. Eventually gets him a crack at a world title, a vacant world title against Christoph Glowacki. Cody wins that. After the fight, he says, you know, you were meant to get me a Rolex. Eddie Hearn goes out and gets him a Rolex. I mean, from what I can see, and Okolie made good money, where Eddie Hearn was fighting on a lot of AJ undercards, so getting great exposure. As far as I'm concerned, Eddie Hearn did a damn fine job for Lawrence Okolie. At the end of the day, his last fight was against Ceslak, which was not a great fight. It was on a Sunday in the O2. The O2 wasn't full, and it didn't look like it did great number, didn't look like it drew much. Is that Eddie Hearn's fault? Well, at the end of the day, like, you got to look at what Lawrence Okolie did in there. He's not going to be encouraging fans to go watch more of his fights when they saw the performance he put in against Ceslak. And I think Okolie is a better fighter than that performance would lead you to believe. He's a much better fighter, much improved. But at the end of the day, Eddie Hearn has done the best he can for him. I took it to mean, when he was talking about it in the summer, that there'd probably be a bit less. His purses that he was maybe getting are maybe going to go down a bit. Why are they going to go down a bit? Probably because the zone, hemorrhaging money. Eddie Hearn 100% took a loss on that show back in February. 100% took a loss on that show. at this stage, they can't, the zone Eddie Hearn can't afford to be taking losses. So if he's going to pay Lawrence Okoli how much he was used to being paid, he's going to want to recoup that money. If he's not, he's not going to do it. So Okoli's probably looking at that thinking, oh, you're not paying me the same amount of money. Well, Sky will. Well, that's all well and good, you know, finish a contract and go to Sky, but don't make it out as though Eddie Hearn hasn't done everything for you. Like, Eddie Hearn is literally, you cannot fault the job he's done for you as a promoter, in my opinion. You can't fault that. So, you know, I'm always one who will take the side of the fighter, but in this situation, you know, I can't really say that Eddie Hearn didn't do a good job with Lawrence Okoli, because in my opinion, he absolutely did. Absolutely did do a great job with him. And as I said, a lot of promoters would have just, after the 2018, they would have just been like, nah, he's going to stink the place out twice in a year. See you later. But Eddie Hearn didn't do that. Eddie Hearn did not do that at all. So, yeah, I think we're pretty much good to go with that. You know, I'm recording this just before we go live. I don't know how long I've actually been recording for. So, if any more news comes to the forefront, then maybe this will go on, because I can always add more to it, because the live I'm going to do is only going to be for about a half hour, 40 minutes, so we wait and see. In fact, actually, I will see about some more news, because I think we can go for a little bit over this. Okay, so there wasn't really much more news to cover. I did see that there was a report that Errol Spence versus Keith Thurman is looking set to be finalized for December 17th. Now, I find that unlikely, given the fact that it's, well, that's less than a month away. You know, I mean, today is the 20th, and tomorrow will be the 21st. So I don't see how you'd have a fight of that magnitude such short notice. You know, now obviously, when I say short notice, maybe the fighters would have known, but you'd put that fight on with a good 6 to 8 weeks to get promotion and stuff like that in. So December 17th, I wouldn't be marking that date in the calendar down if I were you. In terms of other news, I think that's really it. Like, I think I covered it all in the half hour. I didn't realize that Review of the Week was already a half hour long before I went and done the live. So I'll keep this just exit short and sweet. If you could, smash the like button. As I always say when I finish these videos off, I hope you all have a great week. Hope this gets, you know, gets the Monday going. And obviously, we've got more stuff planned. I obviously working on a documentary. Most of it is done. It's just the editing now, which obviously I have someone who does that for me, which thank God for that. I mean, I'd be well out of my depth trying to do that myself. But hopefully, I'll have that out on Thursday. At the very latest, next Sunday. But hopefully, fingers crossed, this coming Thursday, we can premiere that. And yeah, I'm looking forward to that one. I think it's going to be a good one. It's a downfall type video. Well, it's talking about someone who was at a high and is now at a very, very much, you know, like old man's balls low. You know, that sort of way. So it's gone down. So we'll see how that goes. Hopefully we'll get that out on Thursday for people. And yeah, other than that, I hope you all have a great week. Shout out to Jamie. He just hit 5k subs over the weekend. Delighted for him. Next step is 10k for me and for him. Obviously, I'm saying that for him as well. Obviously, next step, once you hit 5k, you're not looking at another one or two. You're looking at 10. And obviously, once I hit 10k, 20k is the next goal. Got to do that in a year? Well, I mean, possibly. I mean, I've got big plans for next year. Big, big plans, you know, in YouTube and outside YouTube. But, you know, it's funny, right? I'm going off tangent here. But the more I think about it, the more I just think, should I just try and just save as much as I can to get to as many shows as I can to see how that goes? But maybe we'll cross that bridge when we get to it. For now, lads and lasses, I'll leave you with that. I hope you have a great week. Hope the phone rings for someone with some good news, myself included. Other than that, smash the like button, hit subscribe, all that good stuff. For now, I'll talk to you. Peace.